When is Jesus coming? Will he come soon? What about the tribulation period? How does the battle of Gog and Magog relate to the beginning of the tribulation period? Well, Gary Stearman has written an article for our September 2009 issue of Prophecy in the News magazine, which he calls The Pre-Tribulation Rapture. It's a fascinating article, has some really good things to chew on here, and Gary's going to tell us all about it. Gary?
Well, J.R., to begin with, I think most people visualize the catching away of the church, the rapture, as in an instant, the Lord descends with a shout and says, come up here. They go with him to be in heaven. And they don't think about the events that might be surrounding that moment in time. For example, where do you place that moment in time? Do you place Jesus' arrival exactly at the beginning of the seven-year tribulation? Well, certainly it's before the tribulation, but do we know how far before? Well, as we begin to ask these questions, I think that you will find some interesting answers.
And by the way, Gary, hasn't this led to all kinds of confusion about the rapture of the church, leaving some to say, well, mid-tribulation rapture,
sure,
or pre-wrath rapture,
exactly,
or post-tribulation rapture? The rapture of the church is one of those things that we just don't know a whole lot about. However, throughout the pages of the New Testament, we are taught the imminency mm-hmm. of the rapture, which means that it could have happened at any moment. Mm-hmm. Nothing had to take place before the rapture of the church as far as first century Christianity was concerned. Mm-hmm. There was no rising of the Antichrist. There was no sitting in the temple of God. Even in 2 Thessalonians, when the Apostle Paul talked about the Antichrist sitting in the temple of God, claiming to be God, he indicated that we would be taken before then, not
right
after that. So the abomination of desolation does not have to take place before the rapture. Therefore, the rapture was imminent.
Imminent. Now, imminent means any moment. Some people will kind of swap those expressions around. Instead of saying the imminent rapture of the church, they'll say the any moment rapture. Jesus could come at any moment. Where do we get that idea? Well, we read the apostles' doctrine, particularly the apostle Paul, encouraged his people. 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he talked about the coming of the Lord as something that could happen virtually instantaneously, and he urged his people to be prepared for that. And so we begin to think of imminency as being prepared for Christ's coming at any moment with no preceding sign. However, J.R., there really is a preceding sign, and that is that according to the apostles, just the straight teaching of the Word of God, the imminency of Jesus' return depends upon Israel's preparation to receive the kingdom. In other words, when Israel is in the land, when there is a temple functioning, Jesus could come at any moment to take out the church, prepare Israel to receive the kingdom. When Israel is not in the land, that imminent coming is not a possibility. That's a strange thought, but it's true.
Now, Gary, that is not taught by mainstream theologians today.
No, it's not.
Not even by the pre-trib people.
Right.
Those who believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. We believe in the imminency of the second coming of Christ. When you go back to the first century, you will find out that all of the New Testament books, except those written by John, were written before the temple was destroyed in AD 70. No wonder then the Apostle Paul, who was killed, by the way, 4 years before the destruction of the temple, the Apostle Paul could talk about imminency or the any moment. The Lord himself shall ascend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, a trump of God, and so on. But once the temple was destroyed in AD 70, men began to doubt.
Yes.
It was Papias who came along and said, don't doubt, hang in there,
right,
don't lose faith, the Lord will come as he said he would come.
And Clement of Rome, actually in his epistle, the epistle of Clement, was trying to encourage people at the end of the first and the beginning of the second centuries to to keep the faith, keep looking for the imminent return of the Lord, and yet their faith was fading.
Now, if you will look very carefully at the writings of John, his epistles, his three epistles, and the book of the Revelation, he does not indicate any moment imminency.
Yes.
He does say, for example, the Lord says, I come quickly, but you got to put that in the context of the vision which he was having, because he was taken into the future to the last days. So, by the time we get to Bar Kokhba and 135, AD 135, and the Romans dispersed the Jews from the land to the slave markets of the world, what happened to imminency?
Imminency disappeared as a concept. In 135 AD, the Jews were scattered, the great diaspora. The temple had been turned into a Roman shrine. It had been trampled under the feet of Roman soldiers. The Jews were no longer present. And from at 135, J.R., until 1948, though imminency was conceivable, in other words, Jesus could have come at any moment, it was not, shall we say, an actuality, because we know from Scripture that after the church is received up to the Lord, in a very brief order of events, the next order of events will be initiating the judgments of the Great Tribulation, which have the effect of placing Israel back in the kingdom again. In other words, Israel has to be a state.
Now, you remember during the Bar Kokhba revolt, Trypho escapes Israel and he goes to Greece. And Justin Martyr just happened to be walking along down one of the streets of Athens one day, and Trypho spots him and begins a conversation with him. And in the course of their discussion, which, by the way, is published, we have the writings of this event written by Justin Martyr around AD 135. And in the course of this, Justin Martyr tells this Jew, Trypho, from Israel, that the Messiah is coming one day when the Jews go back and rebuild their temple.
Yes.
The Messiah will come. So, and when we get to the end of the second century, when Irenaeus wrote, he mentioned that it would be 6,000 years of human history before we get to the second coming of Christ and the setting up of the kingdom. So that's not imminency, is it? Well, 6,000 years from Adam, that's not imminency.
That is not imminency. However, from 135 AD and forward, the doctrine of imminency fell into the background, and it did not rise again until the stirring of Israel, right around 1897, the first Zionist Congress. It looked for all the world as though Israel was coming back and was going to be a state. And J.R., isn't it interesting what happened right around the turn of the century? C.I. Schofield and others began to teach imminency.
Yeah. It's right here in the notes of the Schofield Bible, the Bible I've used ever since I was 10 years old. I won a Schofield Bible by memorizing 250 Bible verses. Okay?
Now you're bragging. So,
oh, sorry. But I was just a kid, you know.
Yes.
But I got me a free Bible after memorizing those 250 Bible verses.
Wow.
A Schofield Bible. I've used Schofield ever since. Schofield was the man who put imminency back on the map. And
right.
I think that's most interesting, don't you? Israel was planning. That was the Balfour Declaration. But it was not until 1948, when Israel was born as a nation among the nations of the world, we had imminency revived.
And J.R., in 1967, when Israel took the Temple Mount, a lot of different people rose up and they started preaching, Jesus is coming soon. I remember it well.
Yes.
Because why? Because now Israel could build a temple. The temple was a feasible thing. And why is that important? Because we know from prophecy that the Antichrist is going to rise up and call himself God in the tribulation temple. And that temple has got to be there in order for prophecy to be fulfilled. And if it's not there, this pushes things back a little bit. Well, in 1967, when it looked like Israel was going to grasp and hold the Temple Mount, Christians got really excited.
Gary, for those who believe in a mid-tribulation rapture, that's not imminency. Because imminency means at any moment.
At any moment.
And if we have to see the Antichrist rise, if we have to see the peace accord confirmed, Daniel 9:27, or anything thereafter, whatever it takes place, like the trumpet judgments or whatever, anything that has to precede the rapture of the church makes the rapture not imminent.
Now, having talked about imminency linked with, and Paul the Apostle links imminency with the appearance of the man of sin in the holy place. It has to be a holy place in existence for that to happen. Having talked about imminency, let's talk about the period of time. It's a very shady transitional period, kind of nebulous period prior to the 7 years of the tribulation. And J.R., we don't spend much time talking about this period ordinarily. But it has occurred to me that the Bible spends quite a bit of time talking about it. For example, in Malachi chapter 4, verses 4 through 6, Malachi says this, "Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, the heart of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse." Now, Elijah's coming before the 7 years of the tribulation. How far before?
Yeah, that's the big question, isn't it?
It is.
What about the Antichrist?
And what about the Antichrist?
He's got to ride forth before the tribulation begins. He can't come along and confirm a covenant.
Right.
Unless he has the credentials to do so.
And another big question, is the church still present on earth during the time when Elijah is working to bring the hearts of the fathers to the children and the children to the fathers before the tribulation? I don't think so. I don't think the church is going to be on earth during the period of Elijah, which means the church is gone before the tribulation.
So the title of his article here in the September 2009 edition of Prophecy in the News is The Pre-Tribulation Rapture. You get that? It's not just a pre-tribulation rapture, it's a pre-tribulation rapture. Listen, you got to get this article and read it for yourself, huh? I want you to do that. You can call the phone number at the bottom of your screen, 1-800-475-1111, and order the magazine for $2.95. That's the September issue. I would like to encourage you to subscribe for the next 12 months when you make your call, because for only $34.95, you can request to begin with the September issue if you want to, and we will send you 4 free books, big, thick books. Let me show them to you. These are 4 books that I have written. This one called They Pierced the Veil and Saw the Future. It's a study of the 12 minor prophets of the Old Testament. Their message, of course, concerns the end time. Guardians of the Grail and the Men Who Plan to Rule the World, The Rise of the Antichrist out of the Roman Empire, and may I say his roots in the Greek Empire as well. Hidden Prophecies in the Song of Moses, the man who wrote the 5 books. Everything he said and did is a prophecy. And I go into that very meticulously to show you things that I guess most other theologians have missed. Then this one, The Mystery of the Menorah and the Hebrew Alphabet. This talks about the meanings of the Hebrew letters, how God could invent the world, the universe, create the universe using the 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet. And The Mystery of the Menorah, those 7 golden lamps of the lampstand that was once in the tabernacle, then in the temple. And the servant lamp that stands above them. What does it mean? There's a mystery there, and it's revealed in this book. These 4 books can be yours absolutely free if you will subscribe to Prophecy in the News magazine today. So don't put it off any longer. Call us, will you? And subscribe today. Gary?
Well, J.R., going a little further with the theme of Elijah, every Passover, during the Passover Seder, the host of the Seder will pour the fourth cup and also the cup of Elijah. They set a place for Elijah at the Passover in the belief that each year Elijah could come back and do the work that he is appointed to do to bring Israel into the kingdom. And as that fourth cup is poured, the host reads these words, "Pour your wrath upon the nations that do not recognize you and upon the nations that do not invoke your name, for they have devoured Jacob and destroyed his habitation. Pour your anger upon them. Let your fiery wrath overtake them. Pursue them with wrath and annihilate them from beneath the heavens of the Lord." Now, this is the cup of Elijah. And what the Jews are saying here is that when Elijah comes, he's going to lead Israel against the enemies, and the enemies will be defeated in a miraculous way. J.R., if he's coming before the tribulation, when does that happen? Could that possibly be coincident with the battle of Gog, of the land of Magog? Because we know that Israel defeats Gog in a glorious way and begins the process then of rebuilding. And the Bible says, according to Malachi, that Elijah's going to be there at that time.
Mm-hmm. And there are ancient rabbinical writings that say that Elijah will come at the battle of Gog and Magog, or during the season,
yes,
or the time when that battle is brewing. Now you have another verse here by Joel talking about the sun turning mm-hmm. black, and the moon turn into darkness, the moon into blood, and then it says, before mm-hmm. the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. So that's a pre-tribulation astronomical problem too.
Yeah, and get the language here. Joel is warning Israel. This is, by the way, a latter-day prophecy. Joel 27. And I will show wonders in the heavens, the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. Sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. Now this would be the time when Elijah has returned. Mm-hmm. And it's a time when the sun's turned to darkness. It's a time when there are pillars of smoke and fire. What makes a pillar of smoke, pray tell? We've all seen the films of the hydrogen bomb tests.
Yes.
That's a pillar of smoke. And it causes particulate matter to rise into the upper atmosphere. It could blot out the sun. It could be volcanism. Volcanoes do the very same thing. Like when Krakatoa exploded, the whole world was shrouded for a period of about a year in dust that made the sun dim. And it made the moon look reddish. Well, this could be far worse than that. And it happens before the tribulation when Elijah is present. So now we're beginning to put together a picture of a pre-tribulation catastrophe of some sort that sets up a scheme that will allow the Antichrist to emerge as a dominant figure. In other words, the Antichrist doesn't come out of thin air. According to Revelation, he rides forth conquering to conquer as one of the four horses. We have the horse of war. We have the horse of economic collapse. We have the horse of famine and of pestilence. And J.R., it's in this context that the Antichrist rides forth, that we have Elijah coming. Where's the church at this? This is before the tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
And where's the church at this time?
We don't know exactly when the church is going to be taken out, but the church could be around to see some of this begin. I'm not saying that we have yet. We do know that back during our election, a white horse was quite prominent.
Yes.
And we've talked about that in the past. The white horse was named El Barak. And I'm not talking about the name of our president. I'm talking about the name of the horse that supposedly Mohammed rode to heaven and back from the Temple Mount. And that Allah told him that in the last days, El Barak would return. So here we have this horse named Thunder, you know, in the stadium up there in Denver. and then we've got Mr. Putin riding bareback, you know, without his shirt, on this red horse in Siberia, telling the Russian people through the photography that he is in charge. So, Gary, we've got a white horse and a red horse this year. And we don't have the tribulation period yet.
Not yet.
What you're saying is the four horsemen of the apocalypse could show up before the tribulation period begins.
At some interval prior to the tribulation. Now, Peter quoted Joel on the day of Pentecost, his first great sermon. He quoted the part about the sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, before the great and notable day of the Lord come. That's Acts 2:20. Peter quotes Joel. And some people are asking him, in essence, what's going on? What is this that we're seeing with people speaking in a divine way and with the Spirit of the Lord moving? And Peter answers, well, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And J.R., what I think he was doing, he was bracketing the age of the church, which began with signs and wonders and which will end in a period of signs and wonders before the tribulation, as Joel put it, before the great and notable day of the Lord come. Mm-hmm.
So the battle of Gog and Magog could happen before the tribulation
yes.
period. How long before is the big question? Give us your thoughts.
Well, my thought initially is that Ezekiel talks about that battle, and he speaks specifically of the time that it'll take to clean up in the wake of the defeat of the great northern enemy, and that time is 7 years. Well, J.R., a lot of people have tried to make that the 7 years of the tribulation, but we know that during the last 3.5 years of the tribulation, Israel is going to be harassed. They'll have to go into hiding. They won't be doing anything at all. Therefore, if they're going to be cleaning up and in a rebuilding phase, they're going to have to start at least 3.5 years before the tribulation. So we could be talking about as much as 3.5 years prior to the tribulation, the Battle of Gog and Magog taking place. And now we have to ask, when's the church going to be taken out?
Yes.
In the context of Elijah and the Battle of Gog and Magog and all these catastrophic events that will occur prior to the tribulation, when will the church go?
Well, I have long felt that the church will be raptured in the midst of a worldwide nuclear war, possibly the Battle of Gog and Magog, because when the smoke clears away, we'll be gone, and the world will think we just were blown up in this nuclear exchange. The world will be coming out from under a terrible war, whereas possibly a fourth of the population of the planet will die during this one day's conflagration. When the bombs come,
yes.
we could be taken. Just as the bombs arrive, we could be taken out. And therefore, the Antichrist would not have to explain what happened to all the Christians, because everybody would be looking for somebody. And there would be people missing all over the planet, regardless of whether they were Christians or Muslims or Buddhists or whatever, or atheists. There would be a lot of people missing, but not all would be taken in the rapture, only the Christians. The rest of them could be evaporated.
Now, quickly, because we're running out of time, the prophet Zephaniah has a latter-day prophecy. And by the way, read Zephaniah and you'll see the most amazing description of the tribulation. But he says this in Zephaniah 2, 1 through 3, and as Zephaniah is writing to Israel, he says, gather yourselves together, yea, gather together, O nation not desired. That certainly sounds like Israel. Before the decree bring forth, before the day passes chaff, before the fierce anger of the Lord come upon you, before the day of the Lord's anger come upon you, seek ye the Lord, all ye meek of the earth which have wrought his judgment. Seek righteousness, seek meekness. It may be that you shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger. Wow, what's he saying to Israel, J.R.? It looks like he's saying, come together, go back to the land, get your affairs in order before the tribulation period, because horrible things are going to be happening and you need to prepare.
As a matter of fact, Gary, with the 1897 Zionist Congress, with the 1917 Balfour Declaration, and with the 1948 birth of Israel, Israel has returned and is returning before the tribulation period sets in. Zephaniah here, though, says that there are other things that will happen before, and basically Israel's preparations for the upcoming Messianic kingdom.
Yes. Now, to recap just a little bit, what do we have here? We have events happening prior to the tribulation period. What initiates the seven-year tribulation? Daniel says that it is the Antichrist himself who fortifies, who strengthens a covenant. That is, he ratifies a covenant, or shall we say he signs it, he approves it. He approves a covenant with the house of David for a seven-year period. And J.R., I believe that covenant has to do with temple worship. He gives them the okay to go up on the Temple Mount and to worship in their temple. Now, prior to the signing of that covenant, which initiates the 7 years, we know that Elijah is going to come. I believe Moses will also come, but that's another story. We know that there will be a war. Joel says that there will be catastrophic events that will even obscure the sun and the moon. That's prior to the tribulation. And therefore, we have a situation in which imminency is now a factor, because today Russia is a world power. Persia is on the rise. The Middle East is in great instability. The Arabs have risen to power, as prophecy said they would. All of this is coming together, and the Jerusalem Temple Institute has prepared the garments and the instruments of the priesthood. J.R., imminency has taken on a whole new allure.
Yes, the temple worship is also just around the corner Israel awaits the events to take place. But when will the church be raptured? Well, the church has to be raptured before the tribulation period. And according to what you're saying here is, it can't happen just minutes before.
No.
There's got to be some more things taking place during that time. Logistically, Israel could experience some of these things, like the appearing of Elijah, the battle of Gog and Magog, and we could be out of here as early as 3.5 years before the tribulation period even sets in. So, hey, look for the imminent rapture. If you don't know him, you need to trust him today. I'm J.R. Church, Gary Stearman. Until next time, keep looking up.